praise the Lord, everyone. Come on in and get your seats in the house. Are you excited to be in the house of the Lord today? Can we stand to our feet this morning? Are you excited to be in the house of the Lord today? I am so thankful to be here. We want to welcome all of our visitors. Why don't we give them a hand? It's so good to see you in the house today. We're glad you came to be with us. We want you to feel right at home this morning. 1 Corinthians 15 and 10. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And His grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain. I am so thankful this morning for the grace of God that's in my life. I don't know where I would be, what I would be doing without the grace of God. The altar of grace, the cross where the blood was shed to forgive our sins, and the waters of forgiveness. Now, I don't know what you was faced this week with. I don't know maybe what you had going on in your life or what you thought you did that was just too bad that God couldn't fix the situation. I'm here to tell you this morning that the grace of God is in this house to meet with us. The grace of God goes far beyond anything we can do, anything we can mess up. Do you believe that in the house? The grace of God is a real truth. I am so thankful for the grace, the mercy, and the love. So as we come to the front this morning for a time of worship, come with your hands lifted high and your heart open, and let's activate that grace this morning and let God take care of the rest for us. In Jesus' name.
This is the place. My God is mighty. Lord Jesus Christ died, he was buried. But thankfully, that wasn't the end of the story. Because he rose again and he's alive forevermore. Can we give him another hand clap of praise? Because he lives, we live today. Hallelujah. The writer in Hebrews said he died once for all. It only took one drop of blood. It only took one man, the Lord Jesus Christ, a perfect man, God in the flesh, to die for our sins. And he paid that ultimate price. For that reason, we can stand here today enjoying the grace and the mercy and the love and the goodness of Almighty God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God bless you. You may make your way back to your seats. What an awesome day to be in the house of the Lord. Thank you for being with us. And in this season of Thanksgiving, this week of Thanksgiving, we know and we understand that ultimately that is what we can be most thankful for. That he didn't stay in the grave. Any other man would have been buried and that would have been the end of his story. But because he was not just any other man, he rose again. And the same resurrection power that raised Jesus from the dead can reside in us today. A few announcements for you. Please see your November bulletin for details on all events here at the Pentecostals of Lee Road. There are some here on the altar if you did not receive one when you walked through the door. We'd also like to welcome all of our guests today and all of our visitors. Thank you for being here. You've honored us with your presence today. Thank you for coming to worship the Lord with us. A few schedule changes this week because of the holiday. No Monday night service or Wednesday night corporate prayer meeting this week due to the Thanksgiving holidays. If you are traveling, please be safe. Spend some time with your family this week and enjoy the fellowship. And I'm sure there will be some food partaking of and everything that is involved with Thanksgiving. Enjoy it and have a blessed time. But we will have no Monday night service or Wednesday night prayer meeting this week. We will reconvene together next Sunday in the Spirit of the Lord. We're going to take a little extra time here with the offering. This is a very special day, as you probably have been informed or you were made aware of when you came in today. This is our harvest offering. Very special time of the year, special day, a special opportunity. And around 500 B.C., a long time ago, over 2,500 years ago, the prophet Malachi, in the Old Testament, posed a very convicting question to the people of Judea. And he said this, "Will a man rob God?" He goes on, "Yet ye have robbed me, but ye say, wherein have we robbed thee?" And he says, "In tithes and offerings." Verse 9, "You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation." Now, thankfully, that was not the end of his proclamation. Thankfully, that was not the end of his prophecy. For he goes on to give the remedy to that curse. He says, "Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open unto you the windows of heaven." Would you look at your neighbor and say, "Windows of heaven"? "And pour you out a blessing that there shall not be room enough to receive it. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes. And he shall not destroy the fruits of your ground. Neither shall your vine cast her fruit before the time in the field, saith the Lord of hosts. And all nations shall call you blessed. For ye shall be a delightsome land, saith the Lord of hosts." Now this portion of scripture is just literally packed with powerful prophetic truths that reveal some things about God's nature and about his priorities. It's the only time in scripture that we find God challenging his people to prove me. It's the only time we find those words said from the Lord, "Prove me." And I get the mental image of God just anxiously awaiting me to put him and his kingdom and his house as the top priority in my life so that he can prove himself. He wants to do that. That's his desire, and I believe it's the will of God for the people of God to be blessed by God. I believe you can prove that scripturally. It is his will for his people to enjoy his blessings. Also in this portion of scripture, this is the third and the last time in scripture we find that phrase, "windows of heaven." And I find this fascinating. So if you don't find this fascinating, then I'm just a weirdo, but Listen to this. I find this absolutely fascinating. To find the first two instances of the windows of heaven, you have to go back to the book of Genesis during the time of Noah, the story of Noah's Ark. Genesis 7 and 11 tells us that in the 600 year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up and the windows of heaven were opened. Then a few verses later, in chapter 8, verse 2, the fountains also of the deep and the windows of heaven were stopped and the rain from heaven was restrained. See, the Lord opened the windows of heaven, then he closed the windows of heaven. Now, to understand the significance of heaven's windows in the context of the flood, we must remember that just a few chapters before that, previously, on the second day of creation, God had separated the waters above from the waters below. Genesis 1, verse 6, and God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so, and God called the firmament heaven. And the evening and the morning were the second day. So on that fateful day of the flood, when God opened the windows of heaven, he created an opening in that firmament, and the waters above were able to reach and unite once again with the waters below. The open windows of heaven allowed what had been separated from the physical earth to supernaturally unite with that which was on the earth. In this instance, they were opened and then closed. But later, the only other time we see that mentioned, God says, I'm ready to open them. And they're not going to be closed. I'm ready to open them. You keep obeying what I said to do. You prove me, and I will keep proving myself. That window will open and it will not close. See, what is separated in the natural sense can and will be joined once again in the supernatural sense. When we prioritize God's kingdom and his mission and his house with our finances, he establishes a supernatural connection and literally floods our lives with provision and divine protection that cannot be explained by anybody else, that doesn't fit the molds of this world, that doesn't fit the paradigm of any economic advisor, because it's supernatural. The harvest, Scripture says, will not be devoured. We're giving a harvest offering today. It's a seed that we are sowing into the kingdom of God. It's a seed. It's saying, God, I'm putting this in your hands, and I want to see what you can do with it. Lord, you can do more with it than what I can do with it. And you know what's best for this than I do. And we're putting that harvest offering in, and the Scripture has promised us it's not going to be devoured, it's not going to be destroyed, and it won't ripen before its time. It will hit its intended mark. It will be used. It will be broken and multiplied by God for his glory. Everything will work out the way God intends because he is true to his word. When the windows of heaven were opened in Noah's day, the ark was able to fulfill its intended purpose of saving those who were in it. The ark is a very obvious symbol of the church. The ark could only fulfill its purpose when the windows of heaven were opened. Your financial commitment to the kingdom of God is what will cause God to open the windows of heaven in your life with the ultimate goal of using you to enable the church to fulfill its intended purpose for this generation. I'd like to say that again. It's your financial commitment. It's you putting into practice what the Bible says to do. It's you obeying what the Lord has put on your heart to do. It's sowing into the kingdom of God. That is what will cause God to open the windows of heaven in your life. And when that happens, you will be enabled to allow the church to fulfill its mission. It can only happen when the windows of heaven can open. We are entering into a season of fulfillment and miraculous provision, but in order for something to be consumed with the power of God, it has to be put on the altar of sacrifice. We're giving a harvest offering this morning to show the Lord that we want his will to be done in our lives and in this church. So whatever you brought to give this morning, I trust it's a sacrifice for you. And as someone else who brought a sacrificial offering this morning, I want to say thank you for joining me to make this church what God intends for it to be. Not one of us can do it alone, but collectively, with you doing your part, with me doing my part, God only knows what can happen. I don't believe we have the full revelation of the vision for what God wants to do and what He wants to, the way He wants to fulfill His prophetic word and what the harvest actually looks like. Because many fruit can come from one single seed. It's a multiplication. It's not just an addition. Can you stand at this time? Your pledge cards, pledge card envelopes were on your seats today. There are two cards inside. One is for you to turn in with your harvest offering today in the envelope, and the other is for you to keep for yourself if you would like to. If you would like a copy, you can just duplicate that on the second card. And the second column on that card says a miracle amount. And what this means is we make a weekly or a monthly pledge, and then the Lord has led us to put a miracle amount. In other words, Lord, I know with my budget this is what I can do on a weekly basis or a monthly basis. But Lord, I want to give you the opportunity. I'm going to put a miracle amount there on the right column, and if you make a way, if you provide that money, if you provide that provision, I'm going to take it as a miracle, and I'm going to return it unto you. Do you believe God wants to do bigger and greater things in your life? Do you believe He wants to use you to bless others? Do you believe He wants to use you to support this oasis in the desert that we call the Pentecostals of Lee Road, in the Lee Road community? Please take this weed. Isn't this awesome? Our staff here at the church does a phenomenal job with all of these materials, but please take this weed as a keepsake. Put it in your Bible or on your refrigerator somewhere as a faith reminder to pray for your seed to come up, to pray and be reminded that, hey, God has promised a harvest. I'm sowing a seed today, and God has promised that nothing can devour it. In time, it will come up and produce fruit in my life. And as you come and place your pledge card and harvest offering envelope in the long basket in the lower altar here, your regular offering can go in the regular offering baskets, but we're asking that you place your pledge cards and your harvest offering in the special basket today. If it's appropriate to join hands with your neighbor, we're going to go to the Lord right now in prayer. If you would bow your heads. Lord Jesus, I thank You so much for Your awesome power and presence that we feel here. God, I just feel You putting Your seal of approval on this service today and on this offering. Lord, I feel like the little lad who was asked to give up his 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And God, I remember the end of the story. I know what You did with it, but it had to be tough for that little lad. But Lord, willingly he gave and said, in Jesus' hands, it can do much more good than what it can do in my hands. And Lord, it was no doubt a sacrifice, but in very soon, in very short order, the multiplication took place, but only after it was given. Lord, I pray a special blessing on Your people today. I know You have spoken to each and every one of us, and You've laid something on our hearts, and I pray we would be obedient. And God, I know You're going to prove Yourself. Lord, we don't give to get, but Your word, You did say to prove You. And Lord, we're proving You today. And Lord, as we sacrifice today and in the days, weeks, and months to come, I pray that Your perfect will would be done in every way, shape, and form in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It is an act of worship to march and give unto the Lord. So as the musicians sing and play, would you do so now? God bless you. Thank you.
provision for seed sown. Time of harvest will come. 35 years of laboring in this field, we've had much harvest. We thank you for the past. We thank you for the present. But we're really looking for the future, because that's where the greatest harvest will come. In the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. This morning, Brother Klein didn't set 107, received the Holy Ghost in Argentina. And we give you praise and glory and honor for that. This church sowed seed into his ministry so that he could go to Argentina. But this seed here that was sown today, it's for this building, that we would build a bigger barn to put more people in, so more people could give, so we could reach more nations. We give to every cause. We're part of the United Pentecostal Church. We give thousands of dollars every year outside these walls. But there's a time we must bring a seed inside these walls so we can prepare for those to be sent out into the harvest field. In a vision, we saw some many multitudes coming through the front door. And as they would come through our doors, there was no wall in the back. They would exit with a bag of seed to go into the world to sow seed. I am so thankful for this church and all of their unselfish giving. For we give beyond these walls and to an eternal harvest that we will never know until we hear you say, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant. Enter into the joys of the Lord." I pray the blessings upon this harvest offering. I pray the blessing upon everyone that has given and those that will give that's absent. And we give you praise. We give you honor. We give you glory. Now would you clap your hands and give him a shout of Holy Ghost praise. The name of the Lord. Brother Derek, you can get this and take this to the office. Come on, let's give him a shout of praise. Give him a shout of praise. I enjoyed the worship songs today. Did you enjoy the worship songs? Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a big shout of praise of hallelujah. I feel the glory of God in the house. I feel the glory of God in the house. Praise the Lord. We have been praying for Brother Mitch Smith. For the last 6 months, he's had a big tumor and a lot of chemotherapy treatments, over 200, I believe. Am I right, Brother Mitch? And the doctor said this week that the tumor has shrunk 3 centimeters. And he said if it will shrink 2 more, they'll just go ahead and zap it out of the way and he won't be bothered with it. I'm going to believe the Lord. He's going to zap it before chemo can get there. I'm praying in the name of the Lord Jesus, by the power of the name Jesus, that healing of everybody's in here that's sick today, I pray by the authority of the Word of God and the power of the name Jesus, heal those bodies that are sick. In Jesus' name, would you give him praise? He is our greatest healer that healeth all diseases. Give somebody a high five. Say, I'm glad to be in church. Amen. You can be seated. You've been up and down. I'm not going to ask you to stand for the reading of the word because you've been doing praising. I want to welcome a special guest we have here today. Becky Travis got married several years ago to a young man, and he moved her off to Tennessee. Brother John Adams, would you stand, please? We'd like to welcome you being here with us today. Thank you for being here. We salute you, man of God, man of the gospel, and we still like him, although he carried one of our girls off. The rule is we try to marry in. Sometimes that don't happen, but we do thank God for that. Remember every announcement, and I'm excited about today, and the songs of the Lord touched me very deeply today, and I am very, very stirred in my heart. I am so thankful that the Lord woke me up this morning. I'm thankful for life, health, strength, and breath. Are you thankful for that? Yeah, but, somebody said. Well, why don't we forget about the yeah, but, and just give him praise that we have life, we have health, we have strength. You may not have what you want, but you have what you need, and therefore we should be thankful. Therefore we should be thankful. My heart was touched today by being in the house of the Lord. So we go into the word of the Lord today. The title of my message today I've chosen, and having spoken to you in 5 weeks or so, we've had just great revival with Brother Klein Dentz. It was unplanned. And it's the things that are unplanned that are very special to you. On vacation, the things that you don't plan are very, very fun and thrilling. And then to have an unplanned revival, then when the prophet of our church has 3 or 4 weeks that he can spend with us, we thank the Kleindienst family for being with us today and his absence. And we're glad that they're here. I want to talk to you about the spirit of thanksgiving. I want to talk to you about the spirit of thanksgiving. 1 Thessalonians 5:18, if you'd flip your Bibles over there, that's where we're going to be reading for. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God and Christ Jesus concerning you. In everything, would you say that with me? In everything, give thanks. Let's say it again. In everything, give thanks. Does that mean just when you want to? Does that mean when you just feel like it? Does that mean when the books balance out? What about when the books don't balance out? It seemed like I read a little verse in Habakkuk chapter 3. It says, although there's no cattle in the stall, there's no fruit on the vine, there's nothing that we can eat, there's nothing that we can drink, yet I will rejoice in the Lord my God. I've come here to tell you today we're living in the season of thanksgiving. And before we leave here today, we're all going to leave here excited to know that regardless of what state we're in, the Lord takes care of all things. And he will continue to take care of you if we will learn to in everything give thanks. Donna's often told the story of her mother waking them up for school and for breakfast and asked them what they want for breakfast. And my wife has literally said that her mother would fix them anything they wanted for breakfast. And often my wife has said that her request would be hamburger and french fries. So before school, my wife didn't have to go to school without a nutritious breakfast, but she got to eat hamburger and homemade french fries. And her mother had another saying, if you are not allowed to come out of the room and sit at the table with a frown on your face or a mad attitude or a bad spirit, she would give them just a few moments to get the frown off their face and get the pouting out of their spirit, or she would say, nobody at this table wants to look at you like you've lost your best friend. So you go back in your room and you stay there till you get happy. And then when you get happy, you can come out of your room and you go join the rest of us happy people at this table. That's what I feel like telling all of us this morning. Why don't we get happy about the house of the Lord? Why don't we get happy about what the Lord has done? Why don't we get happy about, well, I'm not all the way well yet, but you're almost well. Why don't we get happy about what the Lord has done? In everything, give thanks. Now, I got to looking at season, and I got to wanting to understand what season was. And the way my simple mind thinks, I looked at some definitions of what season was. And probably some of you already learned this in science. I think my mind took a vacation when I went to that class, that in math. But season, according to the dictionary, is a division of the year marked by changes in weather, ecology, and hours of daylight. Spring, summer, fall, and winter are determined by the earth rotating around the sun and the plane of axis as it rotates. We usually have little control over the seasons, but every season has a purpose. Think about it this way. If we don't have a cold enough winter, we have to deal with more pestilence. We have had Christmas time around here in South Louisiana that we've been in our shirt sleeves and our short sleeves, and my friends would be in Indiana and Michigan in 20 inches of snow. Right now, if you were in Buffalo, New York, you would be privileged to have 70 inches of snow in your yard. Aren't you glad that our brothers and sisters live in Buffalo, New York, and we're here having liquid sunshine fall on us? And everything give thanks. So if it doesn't get, people gripe about the cold. Well, I'm so cold, you know, and then they gripe about it's hot. But it has to be cold because the bugs have to die and the weeds have to die. And spiritually, we all go through seasons, some good and some bad. But if we have the right attitude, it will all work out for the good. Sometimes things are on top shelf, and we might call it springtime. Suddenly, things heat up, and we enter the summer of the hardship and the struggle. Life may move to more an even keel, and thank God for the fall. But there's one writer of song that wrote this about winter. And oh, how painful winter can be. And winter is not my favorite season. And after, it may not be your favorite, but it may be your favorite. I had a text from a friend this morning, and I said, have great church today. He said, well, we're going to Colorado snow skiing right after service. I thought, go ahead. I'm going to chase the deer. You go do what you want to do, and I'll go do what I want to do. But one writer of song said, if we make it through December, everything's going to be all right. I know. Now, if we can just make it through the wintertime, everything's going to be all right. It's not going to stay springtime in your life. It's not going to stay summertime. It's not going to stay fall, or it's not going to stay winter. But it all depends on what attitude we have. That's when our seasons change. Getting mad about it. My mama used to tell me, you can get glad in the same britches you got mad in. Ever heard that one? But just like nature, no season is wasted. Not a one. You know, I remember the springtime of my life when I was 19 years old. Had a head full of black hair. And I would driving my Gran Torino with my music on and my windows down, drive up to get this beautiful lady here that helped me put in our harvest offering. Her and I were dating. I was an evangelist going from church to church preaching. And she had a Boss Mach 1. And she would always beat me off the line, if you know what beat me off the line is. Her little Mustang Boss could beat my Gran Torino off the line, but I had a better top end. But in the springtime of her life, when her hair was long and black and mine was coal black, that was the springtime of our life. And now at the season of life that we're in now, I have a promise from God in Ecclesiastes 3:1 that says, to everything there is a season and a time to have a purpose under heaven. I can gripe all I want and fuss about the weather and feel sorry for myself if I won't, but it's a waste of breath. It is what it is, and I might as well trust God that he knows what he's doing in the wintertime as well as what he's doing in the springtime. I want to ask you a question today. Where is your trust? Is it trust in Wall Street? Or is it trust in the God of heaven who has made a promise that there's a place and a time for everything? We might as well adjust our attitude and be thankful for whatever season we're in. Our forefathers came to America and almost starved, and many of them did. Do you know that 16.2 million children go to bed hungry every night in America? In America, 16.2 million children in America go all day and go to bed at night without eating one thing. That's America. You get to thinking about how our forefathers almost starved, and many of them did not make it through the cold, brutal winters. But that did not stop them from trying to do their best to get better. The Native Americans taught them how to plant, and they were so grateful after all that year's harvest that they invited the Native Americans who had helped them to a dinner. And that's why we call it a feast on Thanksgiving Day. They didn't have that little box where they go watch the Dallas Cowboys after they ate the pecan pie. What they did have was each other. And I'm afraid sometimes we miss the real story of Thanksgiving. I think sometimes we miss the real purpose of Thanksgiving. It is a time when we all get together and we're happy. All of us are in different seasons of life around my table now. But I can tell you one thing, I am thankful that I at least can get there to that table and sit with them and be thankful for whatever we have to put on that table. I am thankful for the food I eat, the clothes I wear, the car I drive, the house I live in, because I didn't get it by myself. The Lord in heaven gave me the strength to get it. Are you thankful for where you live? Are you thankful for what you eat? Give him praise if you're thankful. Come on, we're in a season of Thanksgiving. Gratitude is an attitude. Tell your neighbor, gratitude is an attitude. You may have more month than you've got money, but look around. It makes us thankful for what we have. I saw this picture Wednesday of William Glenn, 55. He's been homeless 3 years and is warming himself by a steam grate in Detroit. Now that kind of brings things in perspective, doesn't it? How many of you got to go home today and stand over a steam grate to get warm. Well, you don't know where I live, Bishop. Pastor, you don't know where I live. Well, I tell you what, you're not homeless living under a bridge. You're not standing over a steam grate to get warm. You may have aches and pains, but one visit to the Children's Cancer Ward should cure our complaining. Philippians 4:11, not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. A grateful heart is a generous heart. I tell you what's wrong with the world today. They got greedy. They got a greedy hands and filthy hearts. But I pray God would cleanse us today, that we would have an attitude of gratitude, that we would be thankful unto the Lord and bless his name. I've got the Holy Ghost. I've got the power of God. I've got my right mind. I got enough in my belly. I won't go to bed hungry tonight. Somebody ought to be really happy today that you live in America. Give somebody a high five and say, do you have a grateful heart? A grateful heart, say it with me, say a grateful heart is a generous heart. In 35 years of pastoring, I've noticed two things about people. One, those who give the most are seldom the ones who have the most. I looked at a lady one time, and I held a building fund envelope with one of our precious ladies. This has been about 22 years ago. In the other building over there, I held a person who had a lot of money, and they was griping about giving to the church. And I just pulled an envelope and I held it bottom down so she couldn't see the name. But one of our widow women who lived on fixed income put a pretty large harvest offering in on that Sunday. That Sunday happened to be Harvest Sunday. And I said, you know, it must not mean the same thing to you that it means to this person. Because this person that gave in this envelope, they are laying in a convalescent home. And her children and others have to take care of her. But she makes sure that her seed gets to this building with her tithe and offering every time her check comes in. I want to tell you, often the most people that give have the less to give, but they give. And number two, generosity is a state of the heart, and it has little to do with what one has. Paul writes to the church in Macedonia, 2 Corinthians 8, 1 through 4. He writes about this church. Now, I want you to know, dear brothers and sisters, what God in his kindness has done through the churches in Macedonia. They were being tested by many troubles, and they were very poor. But they're also filled with abundant joy, which has overflowed in rich generosity. For I can testify that they gave not only what they could afford, but far more. Say far more. And they did it of their own free will. Say nobody robbed them. They gave it of their free will. And verse 4, they begged us again and again for the privilege of sharing in the gift for the believers in Jerusalem. I truly believe that this can be said about this great church of the Pentecostals of Lee Road. In spite of what you're going through, are the selfish culture around us, you find a way to bless others around you. As a lead pastor of PLLR, y'all give Don and I the greatest joy because you model what I'm speaking about. We thank you for a year of giving and serving and keeping the fires of revival alive at POLR. And thanks for your commitment to our future and your Thanksgiving offering you gave today. We try to use what you give very carefully. What you gave during Brother Kleindienst's first message when he said, I just feel like getting the offering basket out here and you giving in an offering that nobody asked you for. What you gave that night funded a three-week revival that we probably couldn't have paid for, but you saw it possible and you gave, and it was just enough for us to have a revival with our prophet for 3 weeks. Can you give the Lord praise for that? Because of your generosity and your sacrifice, for years we've sponsored missions around the world. We own 17 plus acres at this location. We heat and cool and maintain three large buildings, almost 20,000 square foot in this facility alone. We have two dorms at the campground. We have a beautiful building in Mandeville and 5 to 6 acres in LaRonger. This week, our appraisal came back from the bank that what we own is worth $5.2 million. I think somebody ought to stand to their feet and give the Lord praise. And they had no comp to comp it by, Brother Smith. You heard that before, hadn't you? God's good to the ranch, and is good to POLR. God's good to his people that know how to give. And if you want God to be good to you, you better know how to be generosity. Wrong way to use that word, but you know what I mean. Give somebody a high five and say, I'm blessed. We have a beautiful building in Mandeville, and we own 5 or 6 acres in LaRonger, and 2015 a building will go up there. And that land's paid for. $59,000 we paid. And it's prime property. It's where everybody knows where it is. I believe God's churches ought to be out in front, don't you? I don't believe we ought to be on the backside of nowhere. I believe we ought to be on Main Street. I don't tuck my head and say I'm Pentecostal. I square my shoulders. I hold my head high. I'm glad to be numbered with the Book of Acts crowd. Anybody be glad to be numbered with the Book of Acts crowd? They took Thanksgiving to another level. They knew how to shout. They knew how to dance. They knew how to praise the Lord. That's what the Lord has done through us in our past. But there is just no telling what God will do if you believe. Oh, I wish I had that organ going right now. I'd get down on it just a little bit. Oh, there's no telling. By the past we've had, there's no telling what the Lord is going to do in the future. I'm prophesying to you, Brother Danny and Brother John, that ranch is going to come out on top and be better than it ever was, because the founder had a love for God and young boys, and you revived a dead dream. And when you revive a dead dream, it comes to pass fourfold. And I'm believing God, I'm reviving a dead dream of a dead bishop, Brother T.J. Jenkins. You know where we would be if he hadn't have been here? We'd still be in a tent. Generous hearts reap rich rewards. Proverbs 5:11, the generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered himself. St. Luke 6:38, give, and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that you meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. This is a big promise, but I serve a big God. Now listen, people, we get it all wrong sometimes. If you look at Isaiah 14, it tells you how scrawny and wimpy that the devil really is. But you, if you look at Genesis 1 and 1, you see how big God is. Sometimes we reverse the roles. We have God being real scrawny and the devil being real big. But I come here to tell you, get your thinking straight. Get your stinking thinking straight. God is bigger than anything that you can see or you cannot see. Because if you give, it's going to be given back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, shall men put into your bosom. Some of you got a job you ain't qualified for. But because you gave, God gave you something bigger. I'm asking Sister Haley if she'll get ready to come. Come on up here and get a mic and get ready. I have a big promise, and I have a big God. I can tell you of times when Mom and Dad would have us pray. We prayed every night. And I learned that to bring to our children, and we had family prayer as long as they were home, and Donna and I pray differently now. But I can remember when we were kids coming up, we had what we had because our parents told us we had big promises and we had big gods. Our God was bigger than anything that we would ever face in our life. Generosity pours out of a grateful heart. Even in the direst of situation, a generous heart finds something to give. Because we at POLR are grateful as a church, we try to be generous and do some things outside these walls. This year, the office has done some research and put together a plan so everyone can do something, and together we can do a lot. I'm going to ask Sister Haley if she'll come over here by me. If you have this card, you can look on the back, and I believe that's what she's going to do.
Good morning. The ushers are coming right now, and they're going to be passing out an information card that's going to give you just a little bit of information on what we're going to be doing this Christmas season. We are calling the 4 weeks of December a season of giving. And so basically what we're going to do is each Sunday, beginning November the 30th, is going to be a different giving opportunity that each of us can partake in. And as they're passing them out, you can flip it over on the back and just follow along with me. So on November 30th, we're going to be giving to Tupelo Children's Mansion. And we have two options for you to give on this Sunday. One is just a $5 or $10 Walmart gift card. We're going to combine them and then send them a big gift card from the church. Or we also have the children's Christmas list that they provided the church. And it comes complete with their sizes, what they want for Christmas, what they're wishing for and hoping for. And I have a copy of all of those lists if you would like one. Or you can also see the church office. They have them as well. December the 7th, that's the next Sunday, we are going to be giving to the Lighthouse Ranch for Boys. And based upon the ranch's needs list, we've provided a list for you with the items that will greatly help the ranch. This includes canned peaches, individual chip bags, snack cakes, Pine Sol, Windex, or a Walmart gift card. You can pick one item from this list, or you can bring as many as you want.
Yes, they love snacks. And they need Pine Sol and probably some Free Breeze, too.
The third Sunday, December the 14th, we'll be giving to our local food bank. And on this Sunday, we ask that you bring as many canned goods as you want. Each family can bring one, or if you want to bring more than one, you're welcome to do that. And the last Sunday is December the 21st, and that's our missions offering, because the biggest gift does go to Jesus. And that offering will be taken up during our normal offering time during service. I'd like to share a quick Bible verse with you. It's Matthew 25, verse 34 through 40. And it says, "Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to see me. Then shall the righteous answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and come unto you? And the king shall answer and say unto them, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you have done it unto the least of these my brethren, you have done it unto me." And that's really what the season of giving is all about. It's about us giving as we're given unto the Lord. And I can't do it on my own, and I know you can't either. But if we all bring one item together, combined, I know that God will multiply it. And I believe that each cause that we have listed, it'll be the greatest Christmas donation that they've ever received. Thanks.
Let's give the Lord a praise. She made a good presentation. I am so thankful that we give beyond these walls. God help us if we ever get a greedy hand and a selfish heart. God help us if we ever forget how to give. I have great expectations. One should not give to get, but God does promise that what you sow comes up as a great harvest. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. And God will generously provide all you need. Then you will always have everything you need and plenty left over to share with others. As the scriptures say, they share freely and give generously to the poor. Their good deeds will be remembered forever. For God is the one who provides seed for the farmer, then the bread to eat. In the same way, he will provide and increase your resources and then produce a great harvest of generosity in you. Yes, you will be enriched in every way so that you can always be generous. And when we take your gifts to those who need them, they will thank God. This is your promise. Jesus Christ is not finished blessing us. I'm in the fall of my life, and I'm about to enter the winter season. But I want to tell you one thing. I am just as confident in God that will provide for me when I'm 60 and I'm 60. I'm just as confident today when I turned 60 the other day. I said, God, I'm just as confident that you will take care of me as I'm entering the winter of my life, as I was when I was 20 years old in the spring of my life. I don't care how old you are or what season of life you're in. There's another blessing coming down the road. I said there's a healer coming down the road. I said there's more than you can contain in your basket. You need to get a bigger basket because it's going to be full and running over. Get rid of that small basket and let's get some bigger baskets. And so as I come to the music to prepare, would you stand with me, please? My source of security is not in my 401k, I can tell you. It's not in my retirement. My source of security is in Jesus Christ and his holy promises. For he said, if his eye is on the sparrow, he watches over me. And he said he counts the very hairs of my head. Now, if the God that I serve takes care of the birds of the air, and he takes care of the beasts of the field, and if he takes care of the flowers that grows, and he knows how many hairs I got on my head. Don't you think he's going to take care of me? How much more am I worthy than a sparrow that flies through the air? How much more important to God am I than a beast in the field? I tell you, what separates the two between the animal kingdom and the human kingdom is we got a soul that will live on forever and forever. And I am glad today that God will take care of you and I if we will take care of him. This is the first time we've ever had a church mortgage. But we're learning to lean on the promises of Jesus Christ. We will see a miraculous payoff of this building in the near future. What brings more miracles? Grateful hearts. Do you remember Brother Kleindienst's message? He preached the other night about the 10 lepers. How many of you remember that message? Jesus healed them all. But Brother Kleindienst brought out a point I want to bring back to you today. He said, only one returned to give thanks. And Jesus said, why do you return to give thanks? Where are the other nine? And Jesus said, because you came back to give thanks, I'm not only going to heal you, but I'm going to make you whole. And get this, the other nine that got healed, they had to go show themselves to the priest, but the one that was made whole didn't have to go to the priest because he was made whole. That means where there was no finger, there was a whole finger. That means that half of his face was eat off, it was all back together. That means what the leprosy had destroyed, because he had a grateful heart, the Lord made him whole. And I tell you, that same God's here today to make some people whole. Do you have a grateful heart? Miracles are marked on our calendar. Let's take time to be thankful. It's Sister Kim here. Yeah, I see you now. So these lights. Sister Kim, you remember just about a year ago, you had that aneurysm on that brain, and God healed it. Why don't you just turn around to Brother Mitch and say, it's going to be all right. Brother, she went the day that we prayed for her on prayer meeting on Wednesday night, war on the floor. Thursday morning, they got up to take her to have surgery. They just happened to check her again. And that which was there was gone. No surgery, postponed, canceled. There's more miracles on the calendar. And I think we ought to give God some praise in the house. Brother Ryan, you need to praise God for your mother's miracle that happened this week. Come on, somebody. I feel like from the bottom of our heart, we need to give him thanksgiving. And I'm going to ask you in a moment to just all come to the front, because I don't ever want to dismiss without giving all of us a chance to come pray as a body. But this is what I want us to do when we get here. I want us to pray a prayer of thanksgiving. I want to challenge you when you come to the front. How many things can you thank him for? I thank God I'm not in a wheelchair anymore. I thank God I don't wear diapers anymore. I thank God they don't have to pick me up out of a wheelchair and put me in a bathtub and bathe me like they did. Well, Bishop, you got a long way to go. Yeah, but I come a long ways too. I got a lot to be thankful for. You're still walking on a walker. I had a man ask me the other day, he said, when you gonna start walking? I said, I'm walking. He said, no, when are you going to get rid of this old thing? I said, You don't understand. I'm still walking. You got to know where I come from to be thankful for where I'm at. I'm afraid sometimes we lose a little bit of Thanksgiving because we got too big of a want list. I think we need to just tear up that want list today. We need to throw that want list away, and we need to give God thanks. Then I want you to pray for a better attitude in every season of your life. Then I want you to pray for the seed that's beneath the soil that hadn't come up yet. Then I want you to pray against fear and worry that you'll quit wringing your hands and say, oh, it ain't going to happen to me. It's going to happen to everybody else, but it ain't going to happen to me. Then last, I want you to pray about your future. Lord, let me walk into my future with dignity. Bring me my walker. Oh, it's here right now. I got to get up. Put it up there where I can talk. I'd like for you to come to the altar, and I want to talk to you for a minute. I'd like for everybody here to come to the altar. I want to talk to you from my heart. Let me stand here like that. I know some of you, as you're still coming, I'm going to start talking. I know some of you might think that I'm disabled in a lot of areas and I'm not what I used to be. But there's nothing wrong with my mind. And there's nothing wrong with my heart. And there's nothing wrong with my God or my Holy Ghost. I don't have a successor to follow me. And some of you may be worried about, well, what we're going to do. You know what we're going to do? We're going to put that in God's hands. When God gets ready for a successor, he'll let me know. I don't want you to worry about Bishop ain't keeping up. We're keeping up with all we can keep up. Oh, we may drop some balls sometimes, but there's not a staff in the world that don't drop some balls. But I think we should be thankful for the season that we're in. I didn't ask for this season of my life to happen to me. But I can handle it better at this time than I could when I was 20. God didn't let this happen to me when I was 20 years old. He let it happen to me when I was 47 years old. For the last 13 years, I've had 15 surgeries in 13 years. And I still stand here today with more confidence than I've ever had in a living God that can still heal, save, and deliver. I don't want sympathy or empathy. I just want you to promise me that you'll have a thankful heart, you'll have a generous spirit, and that you'll love to give to others, and that you'll love to give beyond these walls, and you'll always have missions in your heart, and you'll always have a bounce in your step. You'll always have a joy in your spirit, and you'll always have a smile on your face. You promise the Lord that? Can we start to give the Lord thanks right now? Can we just start to give the Lord thanks right now? Can we start to give the Lord thanks right now? Praise the Lord. Donna, won't you come up here and just pray over them? Won't you come pray over them as they're giving thanks?
Jesus, I praise you for the miracles of the past, but we are a people of the future. And Lord, right now, in the name of Jesus, we have our hands reaching toward you. Lord, I pray unfold every promise that you've ever given us. I thank you, God, for where you brought us. Your word says you don't build the house, we build it in vain. And you have built this house. You've built the houses of our family legacies. You've built the house of our own spiritual maturity. You've built the house of our daughter churches. You've built the house that we are standing on today. But Lord, we've got our faith is in the future. Lord, our promises are in our sight. God, you want us to walk in faith. You want us to step out of the boat and walk on water. And Lord Jesus, our children have got to see the miraculous power of God in action. Our grandchildren have got to see the power of God in a supernatural way. And Lord, it's going to happen through our lives. It's going to happen in our everyday lives. I pray, God, for miracles of healing. I pray for miracles of revelation. I pray for miracles of revival. I pray for miracles of breakthrough. I pray miracles of conviction. Conviction that is so strong that it drives people to make their decision to follow you. I pray, God, for a cloud of conviction that is so thick that it will draw people from the north, the south, the east, and the west. And Lord, they would come to us in chains, but you would deliver them. You will come to us bowed down with burdens, but God, you are going to miraculously lift them. In Jesus' name, let your will be done. Let your kingdom come. And let it come here. Let it come now. Let it come to this place. Let it come into our hearts in Jesus' name. Let your will be done in our lives. That's it. Let's just give him our hearts today. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Yes, I do. I give myself away. Thank you, Jesus. Could you wait a minute? Could you wait? Is Brother Wilson Lott here? Close. Would you come up here, brother? I'd said this morning in Sunday teaching that the promises of God are the very best hope you have for your future. I mean, really, that is my hope. That's the best gift you can have, is a promise from God. We've got it in his word. We have it through evangelists or services. That's the greatest thing you can have. But the second great thing you can have is a breakthrough, a spiritual breakthrough. You might not understand what it all means, but you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that God has broken through the veil into a new dimension. Brother Lott, would you mind sharing that? Just the breakthrough.
Some personal choices, just personal choices, and I didn't know why things were going in the direction they were going, but I followed my heart, and I made some decisions to cut some junk out of my life, just junk, and I didn't know how it was going to line up, didn't know where it was going, and I worked with Brother Travis. I don't know if he's here today. I think they're visiting family, and I've been praying for confirmation, and I told Brother Travis, I said, I'm stubborn, I'm hard-headed, I don't like to make a move unless I know God is in it, and Brother Wilkes had prophesied to me about 2 months ago about revelation, that I would be able to read the word and have revelation, not just know what it means, but have revelation in that word. So I took it, and I said, okay, let me just see where this goes, because I'm stubborn and I'm hard-headed. Well, last Monday morning, when Brother Travis came in my office, we were talking, the power of God came into my office, and I was losing my breath. I couldn't speak. Brother Travis started speaking in tongues, and I told Travis, I said, I wish I was somewhere I could just run. And the power of God was just so strong in my office. And as I'm speaking, I have those moments of revelation just hitting me. Because I'm telling Travis, I don't know what's going on in my head. I said, I have a revelation hitting me in my head right now. And because I told Travis, I said, I don't know how it's going to line up. I don't know what's going to happen. And as I'm saying that, God is telling me, I'm not going to show you what I'm leading you to. Because if I show you, you'll put your hands on it and you'll mess it up. So I thank God for the word. And then that Monday night, I'm standing right down here by the Klein Dance, prophesied the exact same thing that Brother Wilkes prophesied to me. And I didn't tell Brother Klein Dance what had happened in my office that day. And then Tuesday morning, I had forgotten some of the word, what Brother Klein Dance had prophesied to me. And I went to see a sick uncle, and I'm way over in Mississippi, and I get a text from Brother Wilkes. And it's that little clip that Brother Kleindienst had prayed over me. And I'm telling you, if we would just cut some junk out of our life, it's not the big stuff that's going to ruin us. It's this little bit of junk.
Yes, I am.
And if we'll cut that junk out of our life, God will move in your life. He'll move in your family. My oldest daughter, 2 weeks ago, prayed right here. My youngest daughter got the Holy Ghost last Sunday. God will move in your life if you let Him.
Thank you, Jesus. I wanted him to tell you that today, because I believe my husband has felt very strongly that next year is going to be a year of supernatural signs, wonders, and miracles, supernatural breakthrough. If we've ever needed it, we need it now. Amen. If we've ever heard the voice of God, we need to hear it now. If we've ever walked in the Spirit, we need to walk in the Spirit now. If we've ever sought Him for divine revelation, we need to do it now. We don't have a lot of time. I don't have the answers for this world, but God does. And let me tell you, we need a clear and a present signal from heaven on what we need to do and where we need to go. And I am telling you, He will open the windows of heaven and will not shut them. I tell you, I got a revelation today. I saw the windows opening. I saw them opening. Let's receive it right now with praise. We receive it, Lord. Speak to us, God. Speak to us, God, and lead us and guide us. I pray Your blessings will flow. But most of all, God, I pray let us hear Your voice and let us walk. Brother Barnes, I have an interview that I have on a little cassette that I did before. We never got to see him after that weekend we preached for him, because my husband went in and had surgery, and we never got to physically see him again. But one of the things he said, would you please promise me, you and your husband both flow in the Spirit? And he said, I go to so many churches that, he said, you can tell there's just not a whole lot of supernatural expectation. He said, whatever you do, would you, when I'm gone, Brother Barnes said that, when I am gone, would you please still believe for the impossible? Because he said, that's the power of the church. He said, let the Spirit be in you like a bloodhound, that whenever someone is lost and they let the little dog smell their clothes, he said, that dog will not stop until it finds it, that scent. And it follows that scent. He said, let the Spirit in you be like a scent seeker. Let it follow. And I'm telling you, I feel the Spirit in the house today. I feel a sanction of the Holy Ghost. Let's just thank Him again, and I'll let you be dismissed. Lord, we give ourselves to You today. Lord, I give You my life. I give You my hopes. I give You my children. I give You my dreams. I give You my resources. Lord, I give You my expectations. I give You my calendar. Lord, I give it to You, Lord. I give You everything, Jesus. The best is yet to come. Do you believe that today? Let's say hallelujah for that. How about that? The best is yet to come, Mitch. Yes, it is. In Jesus' name, y'all have a wonderful Thanksgiving. Love y'all very much. Have a wonderful Thanksgiving.